McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Pitch Like Hollywood, What You Can Learn from the High-Stakes Film Industry by Peter Desberg and Jeffrey Davis. Narrated by Christopher Grove. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the book and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Introduction. Peter Desberg leads a predictable life, and for over 17 years, every Saturday he played tennis with his friend Larry. One day after their workout, Larry said, "I got a story for you." Larry's favorite aunt owned the Laurels Country Club in the Catskills. It was one of the most famous Bush Belt resorts. From the age of 11 on, every summer night he could be found sitting in the back of the hotel's 1,200-seat nightclub listening to all the most popular comedians of the day, like Buddy Hackett and Rodney Dangerfield. He knew comedy. After receiving his MA in psychology, Larry Bresner bought a small, hole-in-the-wall restaurant, installed a tiny stage, and added stand-up comedians to the menu. He found two unknown guys he thought were pretty good, and made a deal to manage them. One of them was Billy Crystal. The other was Robin Williams. Larry not only managed them throughout their careers, but went on to produce many of their films. Here's Larry's story. A writer and I got an idea for a movie. We pitched Toby Emmerich, who runs New Line Studios. Toby shows up with a huge German Shepherd. Toby goes everywhere with this dog. He has a license to take him into restaurants with him. He got some doctor to say it helps him with his vision. He talks to this dog more like he was a colleague. We start off the pitch and we explain it's about a cop and a guy who's marrying the cop's sister. The cop doesn't like the guy because he's a wimp. He takes the guy on a ride-along to scare the shit out of him and get rid of him. In the middle of the pitch, Toby says, "Would you mind if I left the room? I have to make a call." I point out that would leave nobody in the room but us and the dog. He says, "It's fine, he understands. I'll be back in a few minutes and we'll wrap it up." "Wait a minute. Are you saying pitch to the dog?" "Yeah." And he leaves. I look at the writer and he looks at me. We don't know if there's a hidden camera somewhere. Which way do we look more like idiots? He said, "Go on with the pitch." So we made the decision. Fuck it. Let's sell the dog. We're pitching to the shepherd, who's looking at us with a blank stare. "Certainly you guys aren't going on with this." That's the message we're getting from the dog. The writer continues to pitch the story, and Toby doesn't come back for 10 minutes, and we're up to the end where the wimp turns out to be one of the toughest guys ever, and they get married, and Toby comes back in and says he loves it, and he buys it on the spot. 7 years later, they make the movie at a different studio. It was Ride Along with Ice Cube and Kevin Hart. Several scripts were written. I don't know which one the dog chose. When you're in the room, you have to expect that things may not go as you planned. You have to be able to roll with it. Maybe it was the fact that they were willing to pitch the dog that made Emmerich like them enough to buy the project. While you can't plan for every eventuality, the better you prepare and practice, the more likely you'll succeed and the better you'll be able to improvise when you're thrown a curve. This book is designed to help you prepare, practice, and present your pitch. To that end, we've interviewed people who've had a great deal of experience pitching and told us their stories. We talked to some of Hollywood's most experienced professionals in gaming, software development, venture capital, branding, law, advertising, and the airline and auto industries. Why? Would you like to hear an account of the chief technical officer and executive vice president at Boeing describe a pitch where someone is trying to get Boeing involved with a competition to create the first self-flying machine? He thinks Boeing will get tremendous publicity from this, unless someone dies. We've also conducted a thorough examination of the research literature on every aspect of pitching. You'll get a good picture of both the art and science of pitching. As we developed this book, we identified three areas that we hadn't seen covered elsewhere that play a crucial role in pitching: Hollywood pitching techniques, the psychology of persuasion, and managing stage fright. The Hollywood pitch. Hollywood has its own form of pitching. It employs the traditional elements of pitching used in business, but adds other elements to make it more persuasive and emotionally engaging. Hollywood pitches use characters and conflicts to tell stories that leave audiences needing to know more. Hollywood artists have been pitching the same product for over 100 years. Give creative people a quick 100 years, and it's not surprising that they develop a unique type of pitch. Pitches in the business world rely on data-driven decision-making. It was difficult to suppress a yawn just writing that sentence, yet it's there by necessity. But it doesn't mean a pitch has to be boring. Data can also be brought to life by using it to drive emotion. It can function as a source of conflict. Just like a good script or book is referred to as a page-turner, a good pitch should evoke curiosity and conflict. Incorporating elements of the Hollywood pitch can drive emotions that ultimately drive decision-making. The decision about a pitch is often reached within the first 5 to 10 minutes. If you learn to engage people through storytelling, make them want to hear more, and combine their intellect with their emotions, you'll increase the probability of a successful pitch. If there were an algorithm or formula for decision-making, pitching would be pointless. Important decisions could be made after a computer sifted through the data. Research has demonstrated that most decisions end up being reached largely through emotions. Our friend Barry loves to tell the story of how he signed up for boxing lessons at the YMCA. As an IRS estate attorney, Barry talked for years about giving it all up and running with the bulls in Pamplona, living in a castle in Tuscany, or buying a vineyard in Napa. He wanted to travel around the world. But for Barry, there always seemed to be another estate to settle. Everyone was surprised when Barry decided to quit the IRS and take his trip around the world. I got as far as South Africa, where I met Annie, a Swedish woman who I swear could have been Charlize Theron's sister. We began traveling together. One night we found ourselves alone in a small cantina in the Peruvian Andes. 6 campesinos, little Peruvian Indian farmers, came in. I could see machetes under their serapes. One of the campesinos came over and sat down next to Annie and winked at her. Annie said, "We don't want any trouble. He's got 5 friends with him." "It's okay, Barry. He's not bothering me." The campesino slid his chair closer to Annie and took one of her hands in his. He put his other arm around her shoulders. He began kissing her hand, moving up her arm until he got to the nape of her neck. "Barry, it's not okay anymore. Do something." In my best Spanish, I tried to get the cantina owner to help me. He shrugs as if to say, "Hey, these are my steady customers. I don't know you, gringo." I ask the campesino to stop. He gives me a grin and takes his index finger and moves it across his throat, making the sound of a throat being slit. Now he has both hands all over Annie, kissing her on the mouth. As I prepared to die, I thought, I'm about to grab this guy and then all 6 campesinos will pull their machetes, jump in and surround us. I'll be chopped up into small pieces. They'll find chunks of me in the spring thaw. It was that moment when I decided to take boxing lessons at the Y. In Barry's story, there's an ending where he decides to take up boxing. But did it leave you wondering what happened to Barry and Annie that night in the Andes? We hope so, because we wrote the story so you'd still be curious. In a great pitch, you want your audience to lean in to find out what comes next. And because we don't want to leave you hanging, as Barry inched his chair out, preparing to die, the door to the cantina burst open, and 6 very large German tourists wearing sandals with socks came in. Barry explained what was happening, and the tourists told Barry not to worry about the other 5 little guys. "We'll back you up." Barry grabbed the campesino by the back of his coat and pushed him into a chair. Then he bought the German tourists a round of beers. Professor Brian Boyd, in his book The Origin of Stories, Evolution, Cognition, and Fiction, presents the evolution of the use of story. Our book shows the fundamental nature of the effects of story that have become the basis of the Hollywood pitch. Our responses to story are produced from a place deep inside us. British scholar Christopher Booker, in his book, The Seven Basic Plots, makes a strong case for the fact that stories are the way we have always transmitted information. We are wired to do so, and our brains have neatly wrapped themselves around seven basic forms that all stories can be reduced to. It's fundamental to the way we transmit and retain information. Story is more powerful and efficient than simply giving someone a set of facts. By examining how Hollywood works, you'll find yourself asking how you can make your pitch more emotionally appealing, more curiosity-provoking, and more entertaining. More entertaining means less ponderous. We found our ideas reinforced by Kimberly Elsbach, a prominent organizational psychologist. She wanted to do a large-scale analysis of the pitching process. She and her research partner, R.M. Kramer, decided to conduct their research focused on the most difficult pitching environment. They argued that doing so would lead to the greatest generalizability of their findings. They chose Hollywood. They published their findings in an extensive article in the Harvard Business Review. Their research confirmed our belief that pitching is pitching. If you can learn to pitch under the most difficult circumstances, using the best designed approach, you should be able to apply those skills and techniques anywhere. Before stepping into the arena, one of the most important techniques Cass Magda teaches at his martial arts academy is how to defend against a knife attack. If you can't run away, the sane person's choice, you should first learn how to use a knife to attack someone. Knowing how to use a knife helps you understand what someone else intends to do with one. You might be thinking, he wants to stab me. How hard is that to understand? But you'd be wrong. The first principle Magda teaches is that a good knife fighter doesn't want to stab you. He'd have to get too close to you, which would mean he'd put himself in danger. He hopes you'll foolishly reach your hand out so he can slice your wrist or forearm and stand back and watch you bleed to death. If you want to live to fight another day, it's good to learn from a master like Magda. We're not comparing pitching to a knife fight, although there are days when it feels like one. The moral here is that you should understand how things work before stepping into pitch in any arena. Friendly persuasion. The second area we include is the psychology of persuasion. The history of written persuasion begins with Aristotle, but its modern influence dates back to 1936 when Dale Carnegie wrote How to Win Friends and Influence People. It's the most successful self-help book in publishing history. The scientific study of persuasion began during World War II. The U.S. government was supporting research about persuasion, particularly in the area of propaganda. Since then, there's been a flood of research on how decision-making works. Our tax dollars paid for this research in the form of university grants, and it's now being used against us, often without our being aware of its effect on our behavior. All kinds of institutions have benefited. Cable news outlets from Fox to MSNBC use it. You hear it every day on AM talk radio. From there, it's downhill to politicians, their campaign managers, and their advertising and marketing teams. Daniel Kahneman, in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, points out that most decisions, even crucial ones, are made very rapidly. When information fits our knowledge base, core beliefs, or biases, it becomes easier to get to a yes. When the information is discrepant, it forces us to think more deeply. That takes considerably more effort. We don't like to think deeply, even though we believe that we do. Such thinking often makes us more skeptical. We become harder to convince. The research base on persuasion ranges from how car salespeople operate to how you can increase your charisma, to how Billy Graham influenced how much you put into the collection plate at his crusades. Persuasion techniques are often counterintuitive, and those who use them have a tremendous advantage when they pitch. Imagine there's a knock at your door. A man asks permission to put a sloppily lettered 20-foot sign supporting safe driving that will stretch across your front lawn. It'll cover most of your living room window, blocking your view. What are the chances you'd permit him to put up the sign? Think of how you'd reply if you were at the knocked side of the door. In an experiment, the residents in a Los Angeles suburb were divided into two groups. The residents in one group were approached by a salesperson who used a foot-in-the-door technique, and of those residents, 35% were persuaded to let him put up the sign. On the other hand, the technique was not used with the control group, and almost no one in the control group agreed to the sign. All the world's a stage, and most of us have stage fright. What do you do if you start choking or become intimidated when an executive looks at his iPhone in the middle of your pitch, or when you're afraid that word will get out about your lousy pitch and ruin your reputation? You can develop a fantastic pitch, but if you're too anxious to present it well, you'll achieve little beyond annoying the people you're pitching to because you're wasting their time. Worse still, you might end up invoking their pity. Chances are you're a creative person. Creative people are innovative when it comes to describing their ideas and projects. But creativity also comes equipped with an imagination that can turn against you when you begin conjuring fantasies of what might go wrong when you're pitching. Most of us are skilled at scaring ourselves about pitching and do it with abundant creativity. It's not about not knowing how to pitch. It's about getting anxious when called on to do it. That's not really surprising because fear of public speaking is the number one phobia in America. Comedian Jerry Seinfeld says, "The next time you're at a funeral, remember that most people would rather be in the coffin than deliver the eulogy." Everybody gets stage fright. The only piece of the puzzle that sets one person apart from another is the situation. How long do you think it takes to improve your ability to get a handle on it? In one experiment, students who were nervous about taking the graduate record exam were told that if they were nervous before taking the test, that fear would actually help them do better. All it took was hearing that from an expert. They scored 60 points higher on the math part than a control group. Answering versus presenting. People often wonder why it's easier for them to answer questions in front of a group, yet they find themselves terrified giving a prepared presentation. This happens even if it's to the same group of people and you're dealing with the same subject matter. Why should two tasks that are so similar hit your gut so differently? When you make a presentation, there are expectations. You have to keep people's attention for the eternity that passes while you're presenting. In these times of digital distractions and rampant attention deficit disorder, this is no simple task. And because you've had time to prepare, everyone's expecting you to put on a show. A good one. It's even worse because when you're pitching as opposed to everyday public speaking, you're supposed to be a creative idea person, a good storyteller, and an expert. Now, add this stressful thought. You're pitching to people who've heard many pitches before and are comparing yours to the best ones they've ever heard. Chapter 2. Pitch Basics. Actor and writer Charles Grodin completed a screenplay he thought was perfect for producer Alan Ladd Jr. He called to set up an appointment for the pitch. Ladd suggested they meet for lunch. Grodin came to the restaurant with a briefcase containing his screenplay. Before they ordered drinks, Ladd said, "Lately, every meal turns into a writer, director, or actor shoving a screenplay across the table at me, even before I get a chance to examine the menu. You know what, Charlie? It's refreshing enjoying the company of an old friend with no expectations." Grodin intended this meeting to be a pitch. He left lunch carrying home the screenplay that never saw the light of the restaurant. Record producer Benny Medina wanted to get into television. He talked to his mentor, composer and producer Quincy Jones. Medina had a concept for a TV show that came from his experience as a teenager living with Berry Gordy's family in Bel Air. At this time, Medina was managing young artist Will Smith, who was becoming well known for his song, Parents Just Don't Understand. Medina thought Smith was perfect for the lead. Jones had heard about Smith and was familiar with the song. He loved Medina's concept for the Fresh Prince of Bel Air. As it happened, Jones was celebrating his birthday that evening. Among the invited guests was NBC President Brandon Tartikoff. Jones invited Smith and Medina to his birthday party. He loved Medina's concept for the Fresh Prince. He asked Will Smith to get up and sing his song. Smith hesitated. "Listen," Jones said, "everyone who matters in television is in my house tonight. Get up and do the song." Smith performed and Brandon Tartikoff bought the show that night. Medina, Jones, and NBC lawyers stood outside on the front lawn, making the deal. Odds are you aren't going to have lunch with Alan Ladd Jr. or be invited to a party at Quincy Jones's house. These stories illustrate the way meeting a target of opportunity occasionally happens, but you can't count on that. We define a pitch as a scheduled meeting for the specific intention of trying to promote an idea, business project, or script. Such a meeting carries the expectation that you know what you're doing, you've had time to prepare, and your pitch will be better than just good, because whoever you're pitching to has heard the good, the bad, and the ugly. Pitching as problem solving. Greg Dean is a stand-up comedy coach. In his book, Step by Step to Stand-Up Comedy, he writes that stand-up comedians look at their job as ranting. They talk about what's wrong, what makes people angry, and possible solutions to fix it all. They see their job as exposing problems and getting people to think about possible solutions and doing all that while being entertaining. Your job is similar. When you think about it, pitching is problem solving. If you don't have a problem to solve, you have nothing to pitch. It can be a serious problem like pitching an idea for a new type of cure or vaccine, or a product that can clean anything without eventually destroying your water pipes, or a device that makes it easier for people who have lost a limb to control an artificial appendage through their thoughts. Sometimes people may not be aware that a problem exists, and you may have to make them aware of the problem before you pitch your solution. Problem solving is a well-researched area that has thousands of studies and many books written about it. You'll face two different situations. There are problems that most everyone is aware of, such as climate change, homelessness, data security. These kinds of problems need no introduction. But there are other problems that people are unaware of, and your initial task is to make your audience aware of the need for a solution. In either case, one of the obstacles you'll face is that people don't like change. Even if you have a better idea, there's comfort in the status quo when we know that it works. Barriers to problem solving. You may face many obstacles that will make problem solving difficult. Here are just a few of the more common ones. Confirmation bias. When you present an idea, especially if it's new or controversial, you'll encounter one of two reactions. People will agree or disagree with it. Confirmation bias results in different ways of processing the information. If people agree, that's an easy one. We'll talk about many strategies to get people into a more agreeable state before and as you pitch, and how to research your pitch to make this more likely. When people disagree, they listen quite differently because as they listen, they're creating counterarguments to your pitch. We'll present methods for heading this off before it happens and how to deal with it if it does. There's a great deal of research on confirmation bias. Fixation. Fixation is trying the same solution because it's the only one you can think of. If you keep cufflinks in the right-hand corner of your sock drawer and they're not there when you need them, what do you do? Many people will use several search strategies in their sock drawer. Search it back to front, then front to back, sideways. They don't have any other ideas. So it's just theme and variations on the only solution they can think of. Fixation produces poor problem-solving strategies because you can only see a solution in one way, wrong or not. Pitching to a fixated person or group can be mind-numbing. But if you've done your research and are prepared for this, you'll have created workarounds. Functional fixation. This problem blocker is a specific type of fixation that occurs often enough to deserve its own category. It's when the function of an object keeps someone from seeing a different, less common view of it that would solve a problem. Since the 1950s, psychologists have been using tests to measure creativity that use the ability to see multiple uses of objects. They refer to this as ideational fluency. A current example is a breakthrough process for using a specific type of mushroom for construction because it's stronger than concrete. Why was it just found now? Because who ever heard of using mushrooms as a construction solution? Social proof. When you're pitching to a group of people and one or two influential people present contrary opinions, ask hostile questions, or just flat-out disagree with you publicly, it can make your pitch very difficult. They may lead others to reach the same conclusion and to stop thinking. They may close off to your new ideas. Setting your goals for a pitch. The place to begin thinking about creating a pitch is identifying your goals. There's an essential rule for goal setting in any area. Set goals that are directly under your control. Michael H. was a fearsome young tennis player for a top university. Michael was losing a lot of important matches lately. That brought him in to see Peter, a clinical psychologist who specializes in stage fright and performance anxiety. Peter began by asking Michael what his goal was when he went into a match. To win, of course. What's your goal for each point? Michael paused angrily between each word. To win the point. He was acting as if it were his money that was paying for the therapy sessions. Peter asked Michael to picture a scene. You've just blasted a blistering serve with a ton of spin. It's the best serve you've ever hit. Your opponent panics, covers his face with his racket to avoid being hurt. The ball hits his frame, ticks the net, and lands back on your side. Are you disappointed because you lost the point when you've just hit the best serve of your life? Of course not, Michael answered. It was just lousy luck. What other lousy luck could you have during a point that you can't control? A gust of wind could come up. The chair umpire could make a bad call. Someone could scream just as I was about to serve and distract me. Would you like me to go on? I can give you lots more. No, thanks. Tell me what is under your control during a point. I could watch the ball better. I could begin moving to the ball sooner. I could take my racket back earlier. I could determine where I want to place my shot. Peter asked Michael what would happen if he consistently took all the actions he listed as being directly under his control. How would they affect the outcome of each point and ultimately the match? Michael agreed that if he defined goals that were under his control, executed them well, and spent less time being distracted by events that weren't under his control, he'd win many more matches. And he did. Focusing on what's under your control will help give you more confidence and will help guide the preparation of your pitch. Craft your pitch so that you present your ideas in the best possible light. Know your material thoroughly by overlearning it. Demonstrate you can work with others by eliciting comments and avoiding defensiveness. Bring people something they haven't heard before. Listen to what the buyer has to say and be willing to accept and integrate new ideas. These are all under your control. Once you've set your goals, identify metrics to determine how well you're meeting them. If you set a goal for how much time you'll spend practicing, that's easy to measure. If you set a goal for doing research, you can determine which sources you'll examine or how many sources you'll search. Instead of experiencing panic, you can refer to your goals and see how much progress you're making. This will concretize the process and convince you of the progress you're making, instead of your flailing because you're not doing enough. Your likability. Throughout the book, we'll be discussing a number of personal traits that can affect the outcome of your pitch. Susan DeLob Davis has successfully crossed between the business and entertainment worlds. She was an executive at Disney Studios and is currently the treasurer of Riot Games, a major gaming company. Susan DeLob Davis recalls a pitch from a well-known writer-slash-director-slash-producer, Robert Rodriguez, when she was an executive at Disney. Rodriguez was there to talk about the Spy Kids trilogy. It was a clever idea, but not a new one, DeLob Davis says. He came in super excited, super ambitious, but also unexpectedly humble. She calls it humbitious. It means having a strong belief in a product, but being equally humble about it. Disney backed the three films. Now that you've heard an example of how someone increased his likability, let's look at an efficient way to kill it. If you know you're going to present something that goes against your audience's grain, announce that you intend to change your listeners' minds. It'll generate instant animosity. Psychologists have discovered that warning people in a room that you're going to change their minds makes them listen to what you say differently, meaning with mounting hostility. They'll spend their time generating counterarguments. You've challenged them to a duel you can never win. They're now actively seeking reasons to dislike you. Jim Press served as co-president of Chrysler LLC and president of Toyota Motor Sales U.S. Incorporated. He was the president of sales and marketing operations of Chrysler LLC and senior managing director and chief operating officer of Toyota Motor Corporation. He was the first non-Japanese member of Toyota's board of directors. Consider the difference between the Rodriguez story and the following story Jim Press told us. A guy came into the conference room at Toyota wearing Bermuda shorts and flip-flops and carrying a briefcase. He didn't wait to be asked to sit, chose a chair that was higher than those of the executives in the room, stretched his feet out in front of him, and placed the briefcase on his lap. He claimed that inside the briefcase was a design that would double gas mileage. We're already spending $3 billion a year at Toyota in research and engineering. He tries to convince us he's come up with something that our engineers haven't thought of. He tells us it's going to revolutionize the auto industry. Everyone was put off by his sheer arrogance. The guy broke one of the fundamental rules of pitching as it's practiced in Hollywood. Use a story to make your audience want to hear more. During a meeting that lasted more than an hour, this guy never opened his briefcase. He never revealed the design plans that were supposed to be there. The shorts and flip-flops were a clear signal of a deeply frustrating pitch by someone who redefined arrogant. Who's pitching who? People in advertising and public relations rely on the Hollywood model of pitching. By contrast, in business, it's not unusual to find a pitch limiting itself to include only specifications or an estimate of the amount of money a project will make. If the pitch has no emotional content, if there's no story to grab hold of, you increase the likelihood of a bad pitch. Here's what a PR executive went through with a potential clueless client. With a strong background in public relations, Jasmine Bina is CEO of the brand strategy firm Concept Bureau. Jasmine Bina received a one-line email. "We are coming out with a new product. What kind of PR can you get us?" The lack of information here was red flag number one. Bina wrote back, "We'd have to get together and talk. I can't answer your questions about press exposure without knowing more about you and your product." The second red flag came when the potential client agreed to a telephone interview as if she were doing Bina a favor. She didn't understand who was pitching whom. This early in the game, Bina didn't need to pitch her services. but that's how the woman on the other end of the line was acting. She reluctantly walked Bina through a description of the product, but Bina couldn't see what was there. What definitely wasn't there was infectious enthusiasm or a story. This woman didn't understand how the PR process works. Bina described the conversation. She acted as if my work was purely formulaic. The more I explained the nature of what I did, the more resistant she became. Regardless of what I said, she kept repeating the same thing over and over again. No, we want Fox Business. She didn't have a story to sell, and no story, no publicity. I tried to offer an alternative strategy starting with lower-level blogs. Get a buzz going to interest more mainstream periodicals. That's often how news travels. She didn't care to explore anything but Fox Business. I tried to explain that she can buy advertising space, but to get on TV or radio or in newspapers, she'd have to interest people with her story. One of the biggest problems with pitches people show us is that their pitches focus on what they want to say, not what the audience would be interested in hearing. When the Newton fell on Apple. John Sculley was the president of Pepsi when he introduced the idea of the Pepsi Challenge, then served as Pepsi's CEO, and later was the CEO of Apple Computers Incorporated. In the late 1990s, Peter interviewed John Sculley, the former president and CEO of Pepsi, and later CEO of Apple Computers Incorporated. When Peter asked him why he was such an effective presenter, Sculley waved away the compliment. He explained that he had an MBA in marketing. He learned that when he makes a presentation, he first has to identify what people want to know, and that's what he tells them. Pitching would go a lot smoother if we followed Sculley's model. Unfortunately, too many people go into a pitch having mapped out what they want to get across rather than telling people what they want to know. It doesn't matter whether you're pitching a script and want to show off your quirky characters and inventive plot twists, or you're a chief information officer who intends to reorganize the IT system for a corporation using your knowledge of interface design. You can't walk in declaring how innovative you are. The clients have to see how your ideas will help them become more successful. Your pitch must be designed to make sure they see how your idea benefits them. Sculley's philosophy is one of the essential elements of pitching. Hidden agendas. Three criteria, or I'm out. Bijan Khosravi founded Movaz and served as its company's chairman and CEO. He has spent over 20 years in the telecom industry in service provider and equipment supplier companies. He was instrumental in the $4.3 billion merger of Redback and Sierra Networks. Venture capitalist and entrepreneur Bijan Khosravi evaluates whoever's pitching to him using three criteria. First, I ask myself, how well will we work together? I want to know how receptive the person or team will be to me bringing in ideas. Second, Khosravi looks at people's vision. Are they bringing in something new, or are they trying to build a new Facebook? He wants someone who gives him just enough to get his imagination working so he can see future versions of the product being pitched. I want to see a window into an opportunity, he says. Most importantly, Khosravi wants to know what would be his added value. In other words, how can I help get the person from point A to point Z while having fun along the way? If I can't see all that, I'm out. Is pitching the same all over the world? Things become interesting when you pitch overseas. Much of Jim Press's work with Toyota was done in the Far East. In Asia, you don't do a presentation and sell somebody something, Press says. First, you have to create a relationship. In Asia, there is a presupposed hierarchy based on your family name, your political power, or your position. According to Press, vendors will go to Japan and meet with car companies and try to pitch their products or services. That doesn't work. One of the things they don't like about us is that we become agitated when the deal doesn't appear to be progressing, Press noted. They want calm and logical. To gain their trust, you're more likely to start on the golf course or drinking sake. There are ancient prejudices in Asia. When Lexus opened a market in China, it couldn't send Japanese there. The company had to send Americans. Jim Press discusses the problem many Americans have pitching in Japan. They should follow the Hollywood approach, where what happens to a character is not as important as how much you care about that character. Jim points out that in Japan, people don't want to do business with someone until they get to know who they are. A pitch is a conversation. Jim Press believes the most effective pitch is not a sales job, but a conversation. Before working at Toyota, Press worked for a private equity firm. People came in and pitched new business ideas. Press and his colleagues wanted to know the people they'd be getting into business with. What they didn't want was to be talked at. The buyers have to see you as someone who is going to help solve whatever problems they have, Press said. Unless you do that, there's nothing you can say that will persuade anyone. Nicole Fox began her career with Second City. She's a founding partner with Richard Reiner, nephew of Carl Reiner of Lot 31 Entertainment. They are producing The Great American Car Show with David Steinberg. She partnered with David Mamet on a TV project and is working on the feature film The Flaming Jerk, executive produced by Steve Carell. Nicole Fox likes iPads, unless they become part of a pitch. I have a rule when someone pitches to me, no iPads. The invention of the iPad has been a terrible development for pitching. Not long ago, a sci-fi geek came in and had storyboarded the whole story on his iPad. Fine, but that's you flipping through still shots and me looking at them and nobody talking. I think it's great that people are making trailers and reels and shorts, but when you come into pitch and all we're doing is looking at stills on an iPad, we're not talking. I'm buying you first. I need to trust you. I need to like you. How do I do that when both our noses are buried in a device? If you remember only a single concept from this chapter, hold on to this one. Pitching is not selling. Instead of trying to sell, make your goal to create an opening to a conversation, one that benefits the catcher. Sorry, but that's the term that many researchers used. What you must do is convince people you're adding value. The presenter has to sell himself or herself, Jim Press says. You absolutely can't influence anyone with an obviously scripted performance. Here's your popcorn. Let's go to Hollywood. There's a paradigm shift in the entertainment industry. It isn't the first. In 1927, Jack Warner said, "Who wants to see actors talk?" And it hasn't stopped shifting since. It's now common practice for a branding expert, an MBA, and an accountant to be part of the conversation, along with studio executives or producers. Hollywood has refined the pitch to an art form. Chapter 3. The Hollywood Pitch. When psychologists presented information as a series of facts and told the same information in a story format, they found that the information was remembered better when embedded in a story. Information is learned deeper and recalled longer. How much more effective is information presented through story? Ankit Oberoi describes a non-academic experiment where two men used eBay as their lab. They purchased $129 worth of knickknacks and sold them on eBay. They had a series of writers create an interesting historical false narrative for each. They were then able to sell these worthless items for close to $8,000. Stories promote better memory in academic settings as well. When students were given information in a series of stories and the same information as expository text, they remember the information in the stories 50% better. Not only is information presented in story context remembered better, but it ends up being more persuasive. In a series of three studies, investigators presented information about climate change in two formats: factual information and stories. In all three experiments, the stories resulted in greater attitude change and participation in follow-up involvement activities. The information was remembered better as well. Neurocognitive researchers have found that activity in a speaker's brain while telling a story is mirrored in the same area in the listener's brain. The better the listener's comprehension, the stronger the mirroring in his brain. Telling a story has the feeling of having the listener turn it into his own idea or experience as he hears it. There is growing evidence that stories have a greater persuasive effect than fact-based presentations. Stories make it easier to integrate information into one's own beliefs. This isn't surprising when you realize that we've been processing stories since early childhood. Talking about story isn't as effective as experiencing one. Use the link to watch the Google Search reunion video. It was created by Google India to support Google Search. It's a powerful example of the influence of story for the purpose of promoting a product. The background for the story deals with the effects of the partition of India and Pakistan. youtube.com/watch?v=g(hgdn9-o)FJE. Notice that this story doesn't play like a commercial to use Google Search. It's a warm story that just happens to use search tools toward a higher goal. We don't expect you to become a great writer after listening to this chapter. We want to guide you toward improving your skill set. Character, conflict, and structure are at the heart of the Hollywood pitch. The best pitches tell a compelling story using the hook, the logline, and the three-act structure. Essential elements of the Hollywood pitch. The Odd Couple. Although what follows isn't Neil Simon's actual pitch, it could have been. Go through the pitch we created for this well-crafted work. The basic elements of a Hollywood pitch are embedded in it. Notice that this pitch presents the main ideas of the project while amplifying the emotions underlying it. Like any good story, The Odd Couple is based on problem-solving. The characters are faced with one obstacle after another. Each small problem holds our interest and provides more evidence of the bigger problem that exists. The story drives toward a resolution, just as in any good pitch. The elements of a Hollywood pitch. To make hearing about The Odd Couple easier to follow, it'll be helpful to know the key elements you'll find in a Hollywood pitch. After hearing about Oscar and Felix, we'll amplify each of these pitch structures in more detail. Hook, a short, memorable statement designed to stay in your head. Logline, introduces the main conflict and hints at the arc of the story with some specifics. In Hollywood, the hook and the logline are two ways of getting a producer or executive interested in a story. They are big-picture views presented with the intention of enticing people to like your ideas and want to hear more. Once you've gotten through the gauntlet of the hook and the logline, they'll want you to tell them a compelling story with a beginning, middle, and end. Then the story is presented in a three-act structure. Three-act structure. If you think reductionistically, all pitches, whether in the entertainment industry or in business, propose a problem and offer a solution. To tell a story well, you need three elements: character, conflict, and structure, wrapped up in a three-act format. Act 1 sets the scene and introduces conflict and characters. Act 2 increases the conflict and raises the stakes. Act 3 resolves the conflict. The Odd Couple pitch. Hook: saving your friend from suicide could kill you. Logline: picture two guys, one the neatest guy in the world, the other the sloppiest, moving in together and behaving the same way they did with their ex-wives and having all the same problems. Note: because the three-act structure is complex, we thought it would be easier to follow using a script format with Jeffrey and Peter as the characters. Jeffrey is typecast in his role as screenwriting professor, pointing out what to look for in each act, Peter plays the coveted role of the pitcher. Fade in. Interior, classroom, day. Jeffrey. To orient the people you're pitching to, begin Act 1 with a statement of the world as it exists. No one enjoys feeling disoriented, especially at the beginning of a story. Notice that Simon opens his story in a specific place and time, an enormous apartment where a weekly poker game is in progress. The next step is establishing conflict. It gives your protagonist something to want. When we first meet Oscar Madison, he's shown to be the sloppiest man alive, and he likes it that way. The broken refrigerator and the rancid sandwiches are two examples that establish his character. The next task in creating the setup is to introduce the antagonist, Felix Unger, through the use of the poker game. He's set up to be the polar opposite of Oscar in the most annoying ways possible. Pay particular attention to how we learn a tremendous about him before we meet him. He's late. The players find this strange. Not only is he the neatest guy in the world, but he's also obsessively punctual. Something is very wrong. Just before Felix enters, we learn why. His wife is divorcing him, and he sent her a suicide telegram. The last step in Act 1 is the use of Felix's arrival at the poker game. He tries to jump out of Oscar's 11th-story window. Using this inciting incident.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.